This is Frank Morano on AM 970, The Answer. What a tremendous honor this is. I'm getting goosebumps preparing to introduce the gentleman on the phone. Unfortunately, we only have a three-hour show because it would take me a full 3 hours just to list the honors, achievements, and accomplishments of the man joining us now. Obviously, many of us know him best as the host of The Price is Right for a record 35 years, but he's also won 19 Emmy Awards, been named the most popular game show host of all time, received an honorary doctorate, and did something that I think all of us have wanted to do at some point, and that's punch Adam Sandler in the face repeatedly. He also happens to be one of only a handful of people who you can recognize immediately just by hearing his voice, Bob Barker. Oh, excuse me, Dr. Bob Barker. Thank you so much for joining us.
Oh, Frank, thank you for that very flowery introduction. I appreciate it.
It has the added virtue of being true. Now, a lot of folks might remember that that music that I just played. It's one of the biggest hits on the Billboard Top 10 now. It's the second one for a gentleman named Macklemore. I understand you're actually related to Macklemore.
No, 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 no. I am computer illiterate, so I don't... And I intend to die that way, but I don't know what's going on the internet. But I understand that this young man said something about being my stepchild or my grand stepchild.
Yeah,
or something.
I couldn't believe it, and that's why I had to ask you about it. He put
well,
you
I'm
in.
Glad
this...
you did. We've been thinking about trying to get him to do a disclaimer or something, but. I don't know whether it's worth it or not, but in any event, his mentioning of my name in that song, and I might add this is the first time I've heard it, but I've had several people mention that, so he must be pretty popular right now. But in any event, he is absolutely not related to me in any way.
Well, thank you for clearing that up. He is claiming to be your step-grandson, and it's helping him get restaurant reservations all over town, and the rest of us have to wait weeks. So, but now, Doctor,
if that helps him being my step-grandchild helps him get reservations in New York. Being Bob Barker has never helped me to get reservations, particularly.
No wonder you stay on the West Coast.
That's
now,
right.
Mr. Barker.
No, I love New York. Don't misunderstand me.
I have to ask you, now, you did something that was just remarkable. You were at the top of the TV game for a half a century. Now, this is in an era where people, if they're on top of the TV game for 50 days, they're considered a superstar. What was your secret to longevity and success in TV? Do you have any advice for somebody like me that might hope to have a good 50-year run?
Well, I don't really have advice beyond... whatever, when I was first, I started in radio, and this was back in 1946, 47, and at that time, on a local station, you had an opportunity to do everything, and I was a staff announcer. My first job was just writing local news and doing a sportscast, and then I did news on the air and sports on the air, and I'm tone deaf, but I had a disc jockey show and various things, and I loved radio, and I thought, this is what I want to do, but I knew if I were going to do anything on a national level that I had to specialize. And fortunately, there was one day I was on duty as the announcer, and we had an audience participation show there in the studio, and the host didn't show up. This was a guy who wasn't ashamed to take a drink, and he must have taken one too many, but that was my good fortune, because the manager of the station came rushing into the booth, and he said, Bob, you have to get in there and do that show, because everything was live in those days. And I knew the show because it had been on my shift. But
what sort of a show was it? Was it a talk show? Was it a game?
It was an audience participation show. You talk with people in the audience. And I had never even been in a school play. I had never been before an audience before in my life. And I didn't have time to get nervous, and I went charging out there and grabbed the microphone, and I was on the air. And I said something to this lady, and she said something to me. I said something to her, and there was huge laughter, and it actually startled me. And I thought, oh, that's a beautiful sound. I want to try to make them do that again. And I did, and that night when I went home, my wife had heard that show, and she said, Barker, that's what you should do. You did that better than you've ever done anything else.
Wow.
She didn't say I was good. She just said, that's what I did better than anything else. And so we set out from that day on to get me a national show. Now, that's how I just fell into it. And I think that anything that you do in radio or television, no matter how much natural ability you have for it, you need experience. And that's what I would advise young people who want to do something. Don't come to Hollywood. Don't go to New York. Get some experience and then try to make it on the higher level.
And see, the key to your success, I had thought, was speaking into a microphone that had that small tip at the end of it. And I've been using the small microphone, and all the while I'm still just here toiling away. Now, all of us who watched The Price is Right for so many years, and obviously many of us did, just, you know, hearing your voice or saying your name makes me want to bid a dollar on the showcase, but to prevent the overbid. But
either that or have your pet spayed or neutered.
Well, that's exactly what I was going to say. All of us who saw that show remember you finishing almost every show with spay and neuter your pets. Now, you are as dedicated an animal rights activist as anybody. Why are you so passionate about animal rights issues, and how'd you get involved in that?
Well, Frank, I'm like millions of people all across the country who were fortunate enough to be born. I mean, from the first day that they were alive, they loved animals. I loved animals. One of my earliest memories is having a dog. And I loved animals and continue to love animals. And there are millions of us, and we are the people who are working on behalf of animals. I didn't have anything have to happen for me to suddenly start. I felt it. And that's what I've done all my life. I used to save strays and try to help them if they were injured and so on when I was just a boy. I grew up, went through grade school on the Rosebud Indian Reservation up in South Dakota. I lived in a little town of 200 people. And my mother and I lived in this hotel there, which was two stories.
I didn't realize the Barkers were Cherokee, or were they Iroquois?
Sioux.
Sioux?
Sioux.
I didn't know that.
I was part Sioux. My father was part Sioux. My mother was not, and had no Indian blood. But we lived in this hotel that was two stories, and there were steps up to the roof. And when my mother was looking for me, she used to go up on the roof of the hotel and look for the dogs. I always had a pack of dogs with me, and wherever the dogs were, she knew that's where Bob was. So I don't attribute my love of animals to any one thing. I just love them, all of them.
Now, you were pretty influential in getting the city of Los Angeles to pass an ordinance dealing with spaying and neutering pets. What exactly is the case now in Los Angeles, and do you think this should be a model for cities like mine here in New York?
I think that any city that does anything legal to promote spay-neuter is doing the right thing. Overpopulation is one of the most tragic problems, animal problems, that we have in the country. There are just too many cats and dogs being born. And there are people across the country who are spending their time, their energy, and their money trying to find homes for these animals. And unfortunately, these people are doomed to failure because the homes don't exist. The only answer is spay-neuter. And that's why I always close the show that way, and why I formed the DJ&T Foundation, which subsidizes spay-neuters. And it's just a problem that we try desperately to solve. And, of course, it isn't solved as yet, but we're making good strides.
Yeah, you know, speaking of animals, one thing that I didn't know until you brought attention to it was that there was a serious effort in Wyoming, which would have prevented undercover investigations on factory farms. And now there are apparently other states, including Pennsylvania, right here in our listening area, that are considering similar legislation. What is it that these states are doing, and what is your role in this?
Well, we call them ag-gag bills. And it is obviously, the purpose of it is to prevent undercover exposés of cruelty on farms and other agricultural facilities. The animals that are housed there are miserably mistreated. They're killed in terrible ways. They're undergoing just absolutely unacceptable suffering. And you can describe these things, and hopefully you can report that you can report them and hopefully get action. But we have found that the way to really get action is to go in undercover, film it, so you can present it.
Mm-hmm.
And when you present that, you get action from the city governments and from the big companies that are buying the foods that these people produce and so on. And it is really having a great effect. We're very successful.
Yeah, this is something that
these bills are obviously aimed at preventing the expose of animal cruelty. And once they're explained to state governments, they vote them down. They don't pass them. And I'm happy to say we've had a lot of success.
Well, that's wonderful. I mean, if there's anything we could do locally to help with your efforts in this area, please. That is something that is at the heart of the First Amendment. Everybody should know what's going on here. And, you know, talking about your illustrious career, a lot of folks may not realize this, but before you were in TV, and I think even before you were in radio, you actually were a Navy fighter pilot. Is that
right?
You were in the Navy? And you have taken on a cause which so many of the folks in our audience have been passionate about themselves, and that's the issue of traumatic brain injury for military personnel. Can you talk a little bit about what you've done in this area and why this is such a problem?
Well, I was in the Navy. I was in the Navy during the War of 1812. I'll tell you what, before I speak to the question here, I was a Navy fighter pilot during World War II. And had I not been, I probably would never have been in radio or television, and I'll tell you why. I came home. I had a couple of more years of college. I went into the Navy when I was a sophomore, after the sophomore year. And I came home, and I was going to finish and get my degree. And I was married by this time. And I wanted to get a job. And I heard about the manager of a radio station who was crazy about airplanes. He even had a little airplane out at the local airport. And now, I had never even been in a radio station. I knew nothing about radio.
Wow.
I had no experience in that area. As I said earlier, I'd never even been in a school play, nothing. But I thought, if that guy is crazy about airplanes, he might like to have a former fighter pilot work for him. So I put on my naval officer's uniform and my wings of gold. And I went in and I met G. Pearson Ward. And Mr. Ward and I talked for about 45 minutes about airplanes. And I had my first job in radio. And that's where I started, with that little small station, as I had described to you earlier. So I owe a lot to the Navy. And had great experience in the Navy.
Yeah, no, that's good advice for young broadcasters. Join the military.
That's right. Go become a fighter pilot. You have to be a fighter pilot. You can't just join.
So on the issue of traumatic brain injury, how bad is the situation now?
I went on with that long story.
Yeah, no. I'm thrilled that you did.
And now I will answer your question. I think that, well, first of all, these young people, they're coming back from Afghanistan and Iraq too, with these horrible, horrible injuries. Young man or woman, 19, 20 years old, loses both legs, or an arm and a leg, or one just terrible case where both arms and both legs. And then they also have these brain injuries, either just obviously been injured, their brain, or the psychological reaction to what they've been through. And my heart just goes out to them. And so I have helped them, particularly the brain injuries, through Fallen Heroes Fund. And I've helped Semper Fi, and I've helped other...
No, that's terrific. That's terrific.
And I think they need all the help we can give them, just like the animals.
Absolutely. No, that's terrific. If you're just tuning in, this is the legendary voice of Bob Barker, as if you needed me to tell you. He was the host of The Price is Right for 35 years. Every list of the greatest TV personalities, every list of the greatest game show hosts, every list of everything, certainly the best-dressed men, puts him right at the top. What is it, in your view, Bob, that makes shows like The Price is Right so popular? Is it the format of the game? Is it the show's host? What is it, do you think?
Well, my agent would say it's Bob Barker.
naturally.
And who's to argue with him?
Well, yeah, no wonder they're beating down your door to become the next host of Jeopardy when Alex Trebek retires.
Oh, that would be funny. He's younger than I am. that would be hilarious. I tell you what, that show is... Alex Trebek is going to be a tremendous loss, because he's perfect for that show. He's like something out of Central Casting. He handles that show just as it should be handled, and he looks the part, and someone else can do it, but it may not be as successful.
Yeah, I think you're right. It's certainly the game show airwaves will not be the same without both Bob Barker and Alex Trebek. The one issue that I'm hoping you can settle for me is, last weekend we had the Kentucky Derby. The whole world seemingly was transfixed upon Churchill Downs as they were swallowing mint juleps and making bets. And a couple of places that I went, a pretty heated debate developed in relation to the Kentucky Derby about whether or not horse racing itself was animal abuse. And I promised some folks very important to me that were very big fans of yours that I would ask you that question. Do you think horse racing is animal abuse?
I certainly do. I think that there are so many so-called entertainment-type things that are animal abuse. Rodeos, horse racing. Horse racing is terrible. People think these horses are so well-treated. They are raced to the point of death. They are drugged. They are mistreated in various ways and suffer terrible deaths sometimes. But rodeos are terrible. Poachers? Down there, there's one in Miami, or one down in Florida. I can't think of
it. Yeah, I know exactly what you mean, though. The name escapes me, too.
Well, they're terrible, too. They take these huge animals that belong out in the ocean and confine them. It's like putting a human in a bathtub for life.
The aquariums you're talking about?
No, not an aquarium.
Oh, SeaWorld.
SeaWorld, yes. You got it. I'm sorry.
No.
In fact, SeaWorld, I think, in Florida is being sued by Peter right now.
I had seen that. No, that is wild. So your advice, if you care about animals, would be not to patronize sports, so-called sports like horse racing things like that.
Yeah. No. Don't set foot in those places. And, unfortunately, animal lovers love to go to movies that have animals, and movies, the animals are terribly mistreated in the production of movies. So the way to stop that is to stay away from those pictures, and they're supposed to be protected by the American Humane Association, and have supposedly been protected by the AHA for 70 years, and in my opinion, AHA has totally failed in that responsibility.
Hmm.
And it's becoming, there's been, some things have been exposed only recently in that area. And animals in entertainment are almost invariably mistreated.
Hmm. Well, no, that
circuses are terrible for animals.
Yeah, you could see how unhappy the animals look if you ever see them lined up for a circus. They look as if they're tortured.
The best thing that ever happens to a circus animal is the day that animal dies.
Ugh, I hate to hear that.
That's pretty sad.
Ugh.
They have suffered their entire lives since they were babies, and when they die, at last they find release.
You know, I saw that this week your alma mater, the university that actually gave you a doctorate to make you Dr. Bob Barker, Drury University, is unveiling a special Bob Barker exhibit based on items that you're donating. How is that going to look? Are people going to be able to study truth or consequences in the million dollar showcase?
I can just see them getting a major in truth or consequences.
And a Happy Gilmore minor.
And a Happy Gilmore minor, exactly.
Well, that is...
I'll answer your question in just a moment. But that Happy Gilmore, it is amazing what that picture has done for me. I was in that picture. It was released in 1994. And I did Price is Right until 2007. And in all those years, I never taped to Price is Right that the audience didn't want to talk about Happy Gilmore.
You're kidding me. Wow.
And particularly young men. Young men loved that picture. And they want to know, hey, Barker, could you really whip Adam Sandler? Could you beat him up, really? In real life, could you beat him up? And I tell them, are you kidding? Adam Sandler couldn't whip Regis Philbin. And they love it. But
I almost didn't mention it because I figured you get asked about it so often. I figured, oh, he's probably tired of being asked that question. But I'm so glad that you mentioned that. That's funny.
Well, you know, I studied karate for years with Chuck Norris.
I had read that. Yeah, that
sure,
is remarkable.
My body is a deadly weapon.
Well,
it's killing me.
But
what was your question? But
it was
again,
about,
before I wandered off
about the Bob Barker exhibit at Drury University.
Oh, the exhibit, yes. At Drury, yes. They have a plaque. I gave them a plaque that I received when my star was installed on Hollywood's
Walk of Fame.
Walk of Fame on Hollywood Boulevard. I gave them that. Incidentally, I live only about just 6-7 blocks north of Hollywood Boulevard. And just between you and me, sometimes after dark, I sneak down there and polish my star.
You can, you know that you can...
When I do that, I always wear a Monty Hall mask. But I gave them the plaque I got when my star was installed. And I gave them an Emmy. As you said, I've received 19 of them.
Yeah, you got plenty to spare. You could give one along with your Christmas cards, and you'd still have plenty.
I've been spreading them out, and I gave Drury one. And then I gave them really the most, the trophy or award that I'm most proud, happy, and delighted to receive. And that was my award for being installed in the Hall of Fame. So they have those three things.
Wow. Well, yeah,
and they wanted pictures. And they have pictures aplenty. They have pictures of me from practically the time I was born until today.
I've heard they're actually for prospective students in the aftermath of this exhibit. They're going to, if anyone can correctly guess the price of tuition without going over, they get to go to the school for free, from what I've heard. Mr. Bork, you've been so generous with your time, and as if you weren't up to enough with your lobbying against unjust legislation and with your efforts with philanthropy and your efforts sculpting young minds. A lot of folks are curious, what else are you up to all now? What do you do all day?
Well, I'll tell you, Chuck Norris influenced my life. I studied karate with him for years, and the thing that I learned from it was that exercise is so terribly important, particularly as you get older. Now, I'm just around the corner from becoming 90 years old.
I don't believe that. I'd like to see some ID there.
I'll be 90 years old in December of this year.
Wow.
It's taken me a long time to get there.
Yeah, I see you're in such sympathy with animals that you're now counting by dog years for your actual age.
Well, but I still work out. I work out every day. I've worked out now today before you called, and I will continue. Of course, I don't do karate anymore, but I do a lot of stretching, and I lift light weights, and I get on an elliptical machine, and I don't miss a day if I can possibly help it. That, I think exercise and nutrition, they're important at any age, but as you get older, they become more important, and I try to stay in as good shape as you can at 90. And I spend a lot of time on the telephone, just as I am now with you, many days. And if not, I'm talking with various people around the country who are working on animal problems that I'm helping with. And I stay very busy. I'm a complete success at retirement. And I think the reason is that I'm doing something, and doing something that I'm deeply interested in, and that's animal work. I think the people who retire and just sit staring off into space are the ones who are not happy. And they certainly aren't happy if they don't stay in shape, because then they're creeping around. And I try to escape that. And I read. I like to read. I read a lot. And
It sounds like you have a pretty full agenda. I don't know how you have time to, practice your karate with everything else you have in mind.
Well,
but
I've said that I think I'll go back into television and get some rest.
That's what I'm saying. Jeopardy. That is the next chapter.
You think I belong on Jeopardy?
Absolutely. Who is Bob Barker? That's my answer for who should host Jeopardy. Absolutely.
Oh, I appreciate that, Frank. I'm glad you have so much confidence in me.
Without a doubt. And lastly, let me ask you, from the time that you began working in radio and in television to now and just a couple of years ago when you retired, how has the media changed? And do you think it's changed for the better or the worse?
Well,
So you're retired now. You can be honest.
I would like to expand it just a little bit beyond the media. I feel that society has degenerated. Now, I suppose every old man feels, well, it's sure not like it was in the old days. But things just aren't the same. People showed so much more respect for each other, and people showed so much more respect for things, and people, society was so much more pleasant than now, and it's reflected in television, I think. Some of the shows that are on television are disgusting, and unfortunately, some of the movies, I guess, are too. I don't go to pictures, but I understand they are, and politics has degenerated terribly, I think. Even the different parties used to show a certain amount of respect for each other, and I think that's so unfortunate. But as I say, I like all old men, and the old days were better. I hope that the United States doesn't continue in the direction that it's going. And it just is not only changing, but is destroyed. I hope our country can pull itself together and We were and should be the leading country in the world. We shouldn't degenerate into something that's just equal to all the other countries. Many countries have depended on us as leaders. And unfortunately, I think that we're slipping from our position.
What specifically would you change? If you had your druthers and you could, let's say, you could wave a magic wand and instantly change three things about the culture or about the country or about politics, about anything, what would you change?
I'd change the presidents first. And beyond that, let's see, what would I change? I would change the attitude of people toward each other. And I don't mean just the white, black, brown attitude. I mean whites for whites and blacks for blacks and brown for brown. All of us. We should change our attitude toward each other. We're all here. There's only one earth. If we're going to exist on this earth, we should make our attitude toward each other as pleasant as possible and our surroundings as pleasant as possible. That's two things I'd change. What would I change the third thing? The third thing that I would change...
There are editorial writers hanging on your every word right now.
Well, I think that there's so many things that should be changed that I'm trying to be sure that I say the right thing. Three things is not easy for me. Of course, the third thing at least, and may probably move it up toward first. I'd change the attitude of people toward animals.
Yes, of course. There you go. The coarsening of the culture.
More protection for animals. There are, the animals can't speak for themselves. Right now, I don't think there are two groups that deserve more respect and more attention more than the animals and our returning veterans.
Amen. Veterans. Absolutely. Amen.
They face a life that is so tough. Life is tough enough without any kind of disability. And these young men and young women, some of them have terrible disabilities to overcome.
And lastly, Mr. Barker, you've been in broadcasting for over half a century. You've probably given more interviews than most people can dream of. Is there any question in that you've never been asked in an interview? And if so, what is it?
What kind of question have I never been asked?
Yeah.
You know, Frank, I'm afraid I'll fail you. I can't think of anything of any interest that I have not been asked at some time, and some questions of no interest at all that I haven't been asked.
Well, it has been.
That I have been asked.
It has been.
I think this. I'll tell you one thing. You've been so complimentary to me. You do one fine interview yourself. You really do.
You've caused
me to do more thinking than most interviews I've had in my time.
I appreciate that a great deal. That's like saying Joe DiMaggio walking by when you're taking batting practice and saying you have a nice swing. So I appreciate that a great deal.
You have a nice swing, Frank.
My respect for you is infinite. I hope you keep doing what you're doing with respect to animal rights and our veterans and everything else for many, many years to come. And it is a joy to talk with you. I can't thank you enough.
Thank you. I'm flattered that you would want to talk with me. I'm delighted with our interview. And without being presumptuous, would suggest that if you ever want to talk with me again, give me a call.
Be careful what you wish for, as they say. But, Mr. Barker, you know how we have to end the segment. Unfortunately, I'm going to call you back out of retirement to end this segment the way you did every show on The Price is Right.
I shall never forget to remind you to help control the pet population. Have your pets spayed or neutered.
There you have it. Bob Barker has spoken. Ladies and gentlemen, the legendary Bob Barker. This is Frank Morano on AM 970, The Answer. We'll be with you until 4 o'clock this morning. You can call me.